Hello everyone, this is Mr. Cole. Thanks for watching this screencast in order to complete tonight's homework assignment. For this video, you should be on page 12 of your packet. And what we're going to be looking at on this particular chart there for page 12 is the term sectionalism and how sectionalism impacted the United States in the years prior to the Civil War. There's going to be a few vocabulary terms, and you can go ahead and add those to the space there on the bottom of page 12 or anywhere else in your notes that you think is best for you. So this word sectionalism means that you have a fierce loyalty or commitment to your region rather than to the whole country. In other words, if you lived in Georgia, say in 1850, and you would be someone who maybe felt really strongly that you were someone from Georgia, from the South, not so much that you were feeling loyal to your entire country. And what we'll see is that sectionalism creates a divide between people in the North and people in the South, not just over the issue of slavery, but of course the issue of slavery will be the most important issue, but not the only issue. So how was sectionalism related to freedom? Freedom is an important term for us in this unit. Our guiding question is asking you to consider whether or not the Civil War was a war for freedom. And people define freedom basically as winning the interests of their region and not being told what to do by people of the other region. And they were willing to fight and die for the interests of their region. So freedom for them really represented pursuing the ideas and the beliefs and the policies that their region wanted, whether that be the North or the South. So please continue following along there on page 12, and here are some notes that you should add to that chart there on page 12. And after you watch this video, you should complete the writing task on page 13. And I'll talk more about that at the end of the video. So we're going to break this down in terms of social, political, and economic. So first for social there in your chart on page 12, in terms of slavery. The North was con or against slavery. They had free labor, meaning that people were not working as slaves, but in fact working as people who chose what jobs they would or wouldn't do. Many northern states had abolished slavery in the 1780s because it was not profitable. In the South, they were pro-slavery. They had slavery, and then with the invention of the cotton gin, the South relied on slave labor more than ever between 1790 and 1850. So this is a big divide, the biggest divide, again, not the only divide, but the biggest divide between the North and South in the years leading up to the Civil War. For the economic portion of your chart there, here's a few terms that you should know. You don't need to copy this word for word, but make sure you get down some of the main ideas in your notes so that you can understand the chart. So first of all, a tariff. A tariff is a tax that a country puts on goods that are being imported into their country. So if cars are made in Japan and being brought into the United States, a tariff would be a tax that is put on those cars. And what this basically does, it makes the imported goods more expensive, so that in some cases people will buy things made in their own country instead of buying those imports. Then we have the term national bank. This is basically a bank run by the national government. And this would allow the government to lend people money and would also help stabilize the economy. Internal improvements means when the government is spending money to make improvements to infrastructure. And infrastructure is things like canals or roads or bridges or railroads, things that basically help with the foundation of the country, allows people to get around, to travel, allows for better economic opportunities. Because if you have better bridges and railroads and roads, you're able to travel around better and transport goods around the country easier. So keep those definitions in mind as we go over the next part of the chart, which relates to economic divides between the North and the South. So in terms of tariffs, or those taxes on imported goods, So in the North, they were pro or for the tariffs, and they believed that tariffs would protect and reduce competition with foreign goods. In other words, people would buy the things that were produced in the factories of the North. So they liked the idea of a tariff. The South was a con or against. And because this is because in the South there was less industries, there was less factories to protect, and so they weren't worried about protecting their own goods, and tariffs would increase the cost of goods. While it does help people that produce things in the country, it does in some cases raise prices for people that are buying things. In terms of the National Bank, the North supported that. They wanted a strong banking system they thought would stabilize currency and credit, meaning that the value of money would be stable, and so the economy would be stable. The South was against the idea of a national bank. They thought that national banks would be tight or too strict or too stingy with their credit, meaning they wouldn't lend money to most people. And they believe more in locally controlled state banks, which would make things easier to borrow money. In terms of the internal improvements, most people in the North were for them because they thought this would increase trade. This would allow them to ship or transport their goods produced in those factories in the North. And for the South, they traded very little with the West, and so they didn't see the need for these kind of projects. And in fact, they thought these projects were unconstitutional because the federal government was doing too much, basically, or taking on too much responsibility, spending too much money. And so those are kind of the differences between the North and the South. And you can see the quote here from Abraham Lincoln. He's more on the side of the North, favoring things like tariffs, the National Bank, and internal improvements. And the third category there is political, and this relates to our Unit 3 topic of Western expansion, or perhaps Western conquest, depending on how you'd like to refer to it. And in the 1850s, this is kind of the culmination or the end of the United States expanding their control over the entire continent, as you see here in this map. And in the North, it was mixed between pro and con. Some were opposed to westward migration because it would reduce the labor supply for mills and factories. In other words, workers would be leaving to head west, so they wouldn't have as many workers to work the factories. But at the same time, a lot of people in the North favored expansion, but they were against expanding slavery into the West. And in the South, they were for it, and they wanted slavery to expand west, and they believed that it would lead to more cheap labor to help them economically. And as we'll see in other parts of this unit, the question of whether or not slavery would be allowed to expand to the West was a big issue that divided the North and the South. So at this point, based upon those last few slides I just talked about, you should have completed the chart there on page 12. So based upon those notes and those things I was explaining, the second part of this homework assignment is on page 13, where you should, in one or two paragraphs, summarize. And so in one to two paragraphs, please make sure that you're citing details and examples from the notes and the chart there on page 12. The question to answer there on page 13 is basically, how and why did sectionalism create conflict prior to the Civil War? In other words, how did sectionalism, or how did those differences or those disagreements between the North and the South, how would that have led to conflict? Why would that have been not just people disagreeing or people having disagreements, but why would that have led to real conflicts and real problems and eventually a war between those two sections or those two areas of the country, the North and the South? So please go over those notes carefully from page 12. Make sure you're paying attention to the vocabulary terms I went over, and please make sure that you're writing full in complete sentences and full one or two paragraphs, giving details and examples in supporting your answer to this question. Thanks, everyone, and I look forward to reading your responses and your thoughts there on page 13 tomorrow.